Hello and welcome everyone to our brilliant session, Women's Voices Lost in Translation. I'd like to warmly welcome all the panelists, but first a little bit about the panel itself. So Women's Voices Lost in Translation, in this panel we're going to be looking at literature from a global perspective, the impact and role of translations to expand the scope as well as reach of audience, and readership cannot be ignored. When it comes to translated works of literature by women, there's a yawning gap with fewer books by female authors making the cut. While some writers become renowned in their home countries, their works and brilliance is seldom celebrated outside or across English-speaking audiences. The panel strives to trigger a conversation on identifying challenges and moving ahead. So now I'd like to welcome Naima Rashid. Naima Rashid is a writer, poet, and translator. Her first book was Defiance of the Rose, published by Oxford University Press. Her writings appeared in, all right, help me out, Naima.
In a lot of places, would sum it up very well.
All right. The Scores, Lucy Writers, Platforms, Visual Verse, among others. She was long listed for the National Poetry Competition 2019. Her forthcoming works include a translation of the Urdu novel Naula Ki Koti by Ali Akbar Natik, and her own fiction and poetry. She is presently based in the UK. Rabania Sharjeel is a Lahore-based practicing visual artist. She has recently completed her master's in art and design from Beacon House National University. Being the only Pakistani to have an honors degree, in photography, the idea of limiting to a single medium or working with specific interests is unfamiliar to her. Rabania is constantly questioning the possibilities around photography and the way it is seen in Pakistan. Zarmina Ansari is an architect and cultural tourism consultant who graduated with masters from Massachusetts Institute of Technology. She has served as visiting or guest lecturer at various leading educational institutions, including the Indus Valley School of Art and Architecture, University of Karachi, BNU, PNUSVAD, I'm sorry if I don't pronounce it correctly, and NCA Lahore. She has served on interview panels for the Fulbright Scholarship Program, the MIT Educational Council, and the United World Colleges, for which she herself was a recipient, and credits for her commitment to service and activism. As a writer, she has written for national and international publications, including Mazar Bazaar, Design and Visual Culture in Pakistan. Zarmina has also been a producer in different media. She conceived and produced a music video with one of the subcontinent's preeminent singers promoting tourism to the area to encourage poverty alleviation, peace and development. She was also Pakistan's producer for Another Pakistan, a set of interviews of architects, writers, artists and musicians by NPR's Christopher Lydon. She brings her broad and varied experiences to what she calls a bucket list. Her passion project, Joy of Urdu, is a bilingual platform to promote Urdu language and literature. So welcome everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like to start with Zarmina, and if you could tell us, what role does translation play in globalizing and celebrating literature? Works of literature.
Assalamu alaikum, adab, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. So I've been very privileged to live in different parts of the world, and one of the things that I try to do was to read its literature. So obviously the first thing I would say is that the way I got to know a culture was through its literature, to understand how the people thought. But there is another aspect of it, which is that there is cultural resistance to some literature, and very good writers could otherwise get overlooked if they weren't translated. And this is especially true of books that are banned in the original country. And this was true of literature during the Soviet period, where a lot of writers under this in the Soviet times went abroad, or their works were then, you know, smuggled out and then translated. Similarly, things that, in again, taking Russia's example, samizdat was this illegal publishing phenomenon where, you know, these banned books that weren't allowed to come into the USSR, there was an underground industry of retyping them and then creating these self-published kind of things that were coming from the West, and people were reading it. And they ended up highly influencing contemporary writers of that, Soviet writers of that time. So I think when you're talking about cultural resistance and censorship, that's an important thing. But also, you know, everything is not horrible. It's really great as well when you look at the 90s Soviet Union, you want to understand it. There's a book, unfortunately, I don't have a copy of it because I couldn't have it shipped to the UAE. It's on just on the digital format. It's called Sankhya by Zakhar Prilepin, who used, and the funny thing is that Navalny wrote the foreword for it. And now they are completely political opposites. But it really shows a kind of a movement and an understanding of politics today on a world stage just by reading this fictional book. That's contemporary. But even if you go back in history, it, of course, that's true of any literature. It'll make you understand it. So that's...
Naima, would you like to add something to that?
Yes, I think Zarmina has really spoken very well for most of us when she said what she did. But I would just like to add to that I am interested in works of translation and the world needs them, because quite simply, we want to live in a world where our literature, our records of histories and the stories that we leave behind for our children are a just representation of the beautiful diversity of the world. And they're not unfairly or narrowly focused on a certain geographical region or a certain language. That's really the motivation behind, and the compelling reason for focusing on works in translation.
Ravania, would you like to say?
Because you said globalization, so I've seen how these, they've talked about translation jo kaam hota raha hai, lekin mera apna jo personal opinion hai wo, aur meri opinion aur mera connection meri apni zuban se zyada hai, aur kaam bhi maine apni zuban mein zyada kiya hai. To mujhe lagta hai ki jahan globalization ki baat aati hai, wahan pe ग्लोबलाइजेशन का तो मतलब है कि सब इकट्ठे आ जाएं और सब इकट्ठे समझें. तो मुझे ये लगता है कि जो डिस्कनेक्शन है वो ये है कि हमने अपनी जबान को नहीं समझा, इसलिए शायद हम लोग खुद ग्लोबलाइजेशन के बारे में अभी उस तरह से हम ग्लोब पे उस तरह से नहीं हैं, और शायद हम हो नहीं पाएंगे क्योंकि हम अपनी जबान नहीं समझ रहे, हम अपना अदब नहीं समझ रहे और हम उसको ट्रांसलेट नहीं कर रहे. तो मुझे लगता है कि हम बहुत पीछे हैं इस सब से, लेकिन हाँ, मेरे ख्याल से मैं यही कहना चाहूंगी कि ग्लोबलाइजेशन जो है वो अभी हमारे लिए एक मुश्किल लफ्ज़ है, क्योंकि हमने अपनी जबान को नहीं समझा. कल्चर की बात हुई है, हमने अपने कल्चर से खुद डिस्कनेक्ट किया है, अपनी जबान को, अपना सब कुछ हमने डिस्कनेक्ट किया है. तो मुझे लगता है कि ग्लोबलाइजेशन में ग्लोबली हमारी जबान, हमारा अदब, हमारा सारा कल्चर जो है वो उस तरह से ऊपर कभी आया नहीं है, बहुत कम आया है. बहुत कम ट्रांसलेशन प्रोजेक्ट्स हुए हैं, बहुत कम ट्रांसलेटर्स हैं. तो मुझे लगता है टू बिगिन विद हमें अपनी जबान पहले मेरा कनेक्शन अपनी जबान से, तो मुझे लगता है कि अपनी जबान को समझना, पढ़ना, लिखना बेहतर है कि हम, आई थिंक वो तरीका है ग्लोबली अपने कल्चर को पढ़लाने का या अपने काम को पढ़लाने का. सो दिस इज व्हाट आई हैव टू ऐड.
थैंक यू रबानिया फॉर दैट. एंड आई एम गोइंग टू आस्क Zarmine and Naima, both of you. This is a perspective which a millennial or a Generation Z, if you're a millennial or somebody from Gen Z, but this is their perspective that, we're not attuned to, our culture and our language. So what do you, both of you, have to say to that? Zarmine, you'd go first, and then Naima.
Gee, so I'm going to stick to English because I think we have an international audience for this Women in Literature Festival. If it was in Pakistan, I would have spoken in Urdu, but I'm just going to stick to English right now. The platform that I founded, Joy of Urdu, addresses exactly this issue. The fact that many of us grew up doing easy Urdu in O-levels, and then our children are suffering because they don't speak it. So Joy of Urdu really was a way for people like me to reconnect with our literary heritage and understand what we never did growing up. And the same thing, bringing it to our children. I agree that the best way to really make people understand or to share the beauty of this wonderful treasure trove that we have is through translation. And I agree with a lot of what Rabania has said. It's a huge issue right now.
Naima?
Yes, actually, Rabania brought up a very interesting point because it is assumed that when you translate from, say, Urdu to English, you are translating for audiences which are outside of Pakistan or outside of the Urdu-speaking belt, whereas that is not the case. That's one audience, your international audience, but a very valuable segment of the audience is actually people in the Urdu-speaking world who are suffering from this disconnect. And for the one work that is published so far, and the translation by Praveen Shakir, when we were branding or marketing or packaging the work, I was very conscious of the fact that I want to reach an audience which is, hungry for reading in Urdu, but which has genuinely never been shown a way. And in order to reach that audience, aesthetically or design-wise or in the way we orient or frame the book, it's got to make sense to them. It's got to make sense to a younger audience which wants to be excited about Urdu, but which generally just does not know how to do that. So yeah.
True, very true. And so I'll move on to my next question, Naima, and perhaps Rabania, you can answer after that. So do you believe the dearth of translated literature by women in English language markets is a deeply rooted bias of predominantly male figures in the literary arena, including translation and publishing industries? And of course, we must not fall prey to making a generalization here by accusing only our male counterparts, but really, who are the gatekeepers that are leaving women in literature behind when it comes to globalizing works of literature through translation?
All that I have to say and all that I have to get off my chest in response to this question will never fit in the scope of a panel. But I will say that I think it's everyone's responsibility everyone who's interested in world literature and translation. They have to understand the journey that a work of translation goes through from conception to execution when it actually goes out in the world. And then understanding how at every touch point and at every step of the way, there are gatekeepers. And the reason why a lot of literature from our part of the world never makes it through to international markets or is not translated as widely is because at the very first step or at the very second step, there are so many obstacles that it's pretty nearly impossible to remain committed to translation in the long run. For example, a work of translation, you said that we should avoid generalization, and I agree with you. So I'll give you a very specific example. As a woman wanting to translate the work of a woman, of a Pakistani writer, I want to translate it. It will be a personal project for me because no publisher is sitting there working with an agenda that we have to have, 50 translations out per year. Nobody is doing that. So it'll be a personal decision. And from that point onwards, everything that I do, for example, first I will go and inquire about the rights. Then I will go and approach a publisher. All of that, you just imagine and map it out in the number of hours. And mostly, you never make it past the second step because For example, if I'm a woman and I want to translate this work by a Pakistani female writer, the first block will be the issue of rights, because there'll be guardianship around rights. Now, you could very well turn around and ask me, you know, what possible issue could somebody have? If a translator is excited about and is willing to translate their work in English? And that's a perfectly legitimate question, and I don't have the answer. But what I can tell you is that for one project that I'm very keen on doing, I have already spent 3 years chasing the publisher who holds their copyrights, and I have made no progress. And after some time, you have to look at translation projects from a pragmatic angle, because they are riddled with issues of sustainability. I run a family, I have a full-time business, I have my own writing, and translation comes after all of that. So why should I have to spend 3 years chasing a publisher simply because I want to translate a work and I want to put it out there? And I want to compete, or I want the project to go out after all the levels of control, after all the levels of quality control that must be implemented before a work goes out into the world. So why should there be an obstacle? So these issues like, you know, corruption and structural dysfunction, these are issues which actually stop you at step number one or step number two. We're talking about and the rest of the funnel, which is, you know, the quality controls and the more sophisticated forms of putting works of translation out, like how you package them, that comes much later. Most translators in Pakistan, particularly most female translators in Pakistan, will never make it past step two. So.
So Rabania, would you like to add something to that?
Bilkul, I think absolutely. Par Sabine, mein, I will start from this ke ye koi hum isse unfamiliar nahi hai, matlab ye jo translation ka kaam hai aur aurtein bahut sari cheezon mein, sirf translation mein nahi, adab mein ya spaces chala rahi hain ya apna online business kar rahi hain. Generally khair puri duniya mein hi is cheez ki behas hai, lekin Pakistan mein hum is cheez ko अब बहुत अच्छे तरीके से इसके बारे में आवाज उठा रहे हैं कि औरतों को बहुत सारे मसाइल हैं, और ये उन औरतों के भी हैं जो अवेयर भी हैं अपने राइट्स के बारे में. तो अगर मैं अपने राइट्स के बारे में अवेयर हूँ और मैं समझती हूँ कि मैं काम लिख रही हूँ और मैं लोगों को जानती हूँ और मैं एक्सेस कर सकती हूँ और मैं किताब छाप सकती हूँ, मेरे लिए उस तरह से आसानी नहीं है. और मुझे लगता है कि इट्स नॉट ओनली इन पब्लिशिंग और राइटिंग, हर चीज में है. अगर मैं सिर्फ अपनी एग्जांपल ही रखूँ कि मैं पिछले 5-6 सालों से तस्वीर घर चला रही हूँ, जिसमें मेरी अपनी कोशिश है कि जो चीज मैंने चलाई है, द स्पेस दैट आई एम रनिंग, उसका नाम ही उर्दू में है, उसके उसके जो ब्लॉग लिखे जाते हैं उसके टाइटल्स उर्दू में है, हर चीज उर्दू में है. क्योंकि मैं बार बार ये चीज कोट करती हूँ कि हम सोचते उर्दू में, लेकिन हमें बताया ये जाता है कि आप आर्ट इंग्लिश में करो, अंग्रेजी में आर्ट बनाओ, लेकिन सोचो उर्दू. हम सोचते ही उर्दू में, हम अंग्रेजी में आर्ट कैसे बना सकते हैं? तो हमारे यहाँ से तस्वीरघर से जब सर्टिफिकेट्स भी जाते हैं वॉलंटियर्स को, तो वो उर्दू में जाते हैं, और मैंने कहीं नहीं देखा कि उर्दू में सर्टिफिकेट्स जाएं. ये कोशिश हम इसलिए, और मैं ये कहती हूँ कि मैं ये कोशिश कर रही हूँ, मैं जानती हूँ कि मेरे साथ और इतनी औरतें हैं जो ये कोशिश कर रही हैं और इतनी एफिशिएंसी से कर रही हैं, पर मुझे लगता है कि वो चीज आगे उतनी सेलिब्रेट नहीं की जाती या इवन एक्नॉलेज भी नहीं की जाती. पर जब एज अ औरत आप खुद फर्स्ट स्टेज पे जाते हो कि अच्छा यार एक्चुअली व्हाट्स द रूट प्रॉब्लम, एंड देन जेंडर उधर आ जाते हो और आपको समझ आती है कि ओ अच्छा, इट्स जस्ट बिकॉज के मैं औरत हूँ, मेरी औरतों की टीम है, मैंने वॉलंटियर्स औरतें रखी हुई हैं, औरतें जाती हैं, रिप्रेजेंट करती हैं, औरतें बात करती हैं, औरतें फेस हैं इसका, औरत ने लिखा है. एंड आई थिंक के अब तो हम अब क्या कहते हैं, अब हम एक्नॉलेज भी कर चुके हैं, और हम आई थिंक अब इट्स अ टाइम वेयर वी ऑल आर काइंड ऑफ कमिंग टुगेदर एंड सेइंग कि अच्छा वी हैव हैड इनफ, एंड हम चाहते हैं कि हम औरतों का काम आगे सेलिब्रेट करें. तो मुझे लगता है कि ये जिस तरह के ये पैनल्स हैं और इस तरह के फेस्टिवल्स हैं, इसमें ही सबसे ज्यादा कोशिश है. इंडिविजुअली तो हम कर रहे हैं, लेकिन कलेक्टिवली हमें आना है साथ. तो मुझे लगता है कि अब ये हम कर रहे हैं, लेकिन इस चीज में हम बिल्कुल भी अनफेमिलियर नहीं है. हम मेरे ख्याल से इसीलिए इतना फ्रस्ट्रेट कर गए हैं और इसीलिए और भी ज्यादा कोशिश कर रहे हैं, और मेरे ख्याल से और भी ज्यादा हमें आगे जाके अपने आप को प्रूव करने की कोशिश करते हैं, बिकॉज हमें इन द एंड ये फील होता है कि हम शायद औरतें हैं और औरत होकर हमें वो चांसेस नहीं मिल रहे या वो एक्नॉलेजमेंट नहीं मिल रही। तो ये बिल्कुल है आपका जो सवाल है कि इस औरत होने, औरत का काम से लिबरेट करना या औरत का और काम आगे आना, इवन ट्रांसलेशन में भी हम खुद देखते हैं कि कितने आदमियों की पोइट्री और कहानियां और नॉवेल अवेलेबल हैं और कितनी औरतों के, पिछली जनरेशन्स में आप कितने भी देख लें, और कितने आदमियों की वो न्यूज़ के ऊपर चलती है कि जी आज इतने आदमियों, इतने ये शायर थे या ये एक्टर थे उनको आज फौत हुए हुए इतने साल हो गए, और कितनी औरतों को हम सेलिब्रेट करते हैं। तो ये दिस इज नॉट समथिंग, ये तो हमने एक्सेप्ट कर लिया, मुझे लगता है हमने एक्सेप्ट कर लिया था, लेकिन अब कुछ सालों से हम इसके इसके अगेंस्ट खड़े हो रहे हैं, तो मुझे लगता है कि अभी बेहतर हो रहा है।
सो you know what you know it, what gets me is you know we're saying publishers are the gatekeepers, right? So how do we, you know, like Naima, you're thinking of doing a project and you're chasing a publisher, and you know, at the end of the day, if you look at from a scalability and a, you know, from a point of view, from a business point of view as well, let's, you know, because it your effort is, you know, like Zarmina said, you know, time is money, and you know, your effort, you know, there's a value to it as well. So, you know, if we keep on doing things all by ourselves, you know, that doesn't make sense. Would you agree with me on that?
Absolutely, Sabine, that's what I was trying to say, that, you know, for example, the leading publishing houses in Pakistan, it should be part of their agenda to commission 10 or 20 works of translators, because we have excellent translators in Pakistan. And it should be part of their agenda. And this agenda should be, you know, with this mission to promote a cultural legacy. It might not have the kind of financial returns that you receive for commercial fictions, but look at other regions, look at the Arab world, look at the way how aggressively they are funding their translations, and look at us. So this publisher that I'm chasing, by the way, this is a publisher in Urdu who holds the rights to the Urdu works of an author that I want to translate, but I haven't been able to, you know, get them to agree. So,
yeah, you know, you mentioned, you know, the Arab world, and I can give you an example of the UAE. They have this entire platform where, you know, translations, you know, can, and I may be a little wrong, but you know, as far as I know, you know, all the translations, works of translations are done for free. So that's like a government initiative.
Exactly.
So yeah, you know.
Sabine, it does not also have to be done for free. I know, for example, that there's a lot of funding allocated for translation works, yeah. But then again, as long as it's, you know, one dedicated translator knocking on doors, or two or three or 10, that's simply not good enough, because it will at best be a personal effort and a sporadic effort. Whereas what we need is a strategic effort. And it should be the government's responsibility. It should be the responsibility of, you know, some leading publishers like OUP and some very interesting upcoming publishers. They should have some sort of consortium on which they agree on an agenda for translation and then commission rapidly.
True. And, you know, the example I'm giving of UAE, it, you know, they're doing that so that Arabic is more globalized. You know, the idea behind that is, you know, they're incentivizing it, you know, by saying that, you know, of course, you know, it won't be free, but, you know, the idea is to globalize it, you know.
Bilkul, absolutely. And just one little point about that, when you talk about globalizing and when you talk about a work in one language having impact and visibility in the rest of the world, I think it's important to talk about the prejudices and biases inherent in platforms like prizes, because they are, as shallow as it may seem, they are big determinants of which work gets to be spoken about, which work, you know, makes it out there, and which work is forgotten. So they are all basically serving agendas related to languages, and we have none.
True, absolutely true. And I'll go to my next question. And Zarmine, perhaps you can start, you can answer this one. So I believe it is really important to have this conversation about bringing works of literature in other languages in the global literary foray. So why isn't this conversation happening? Or if it is happening, why don't we see the results? I saw this amazing festival event happening in 2019. But, there isn't, or am I wrong in saying that there isn't that impactful a conversation happening right now, Zarmine?
I'm not sure about whether, I think conversations like this are happening. Obviously not at the larger scale that Naima mentioned, that should be part of the agenda of more publishing houses, especially in our part of the world. But I'll give you an example. This thing about translation and about women's publishing, it's true actually all over the world. You had mentioned about sort of the deeply rooted bias. So I just have a quick thing to show you. I have a huge collection of Russian translated literature, right? So I only have Anna Akhmatova, Marina Tsvetaeva, and Tatiana Tolstaya, just three of the women. Two of them are during the Soviet time. One is a little bit more, sort of more contemporary. There's nothing from, I don't even know if classical Russian, do you know any women, except, I don't, right? Okay, yeah. So you have, this is World War, this is brilliant. This writer, why doesn't everybody know about it? If you know Flaubert, if you know, I don't know, Zola, if you know Hugo, you should know Irene Nemirovsky as well. It's absolutely stunning. They made a terrible movie as well. But it's because they only found out her works because she wrote on very tiny pieces of paper. She ran away, then she was taken away by the German, by the Nazis and executed. And then her great granddaughter or granddaughter found this these manuscripts and had them printed in French, and they were absolutely taken aback. Although she was a well-known writer when the Germans invaded France, she was a well-known writer, but then she got forgotten. And she got forgotten by the rest of the world because her work wasn't translated. And so when these new manuscripts were found and they were printed, and then like Sweet Française, Irene Nemirovsky, that's when suddenly people realized how amazing she was, and she just never could see. But today we have Amélie Nothomb. Every year she publishes a book. At the same time, immediately you have her English translation because she is commercially successful. At the same time, you have the greatest Urdu stories ever told. And in this, there are, which is something that we use in this popular session that we have with our Dr. Arfa called Himakatein. And out of 25 translated stories, there are five or six by women, mm-hmm. which I think is actually great because, except for the two or three usual suspects, you don't come across many of the names. So that's great. We're getting there. We need to have more conversations, clearly.
True. And you know what? I've got a treasure trove of Russian literature, which is, I think, 80, 90 years old, because that belonged to my grandfather. Mm-hmm. I've got Gorky, I've got Tolstoy, I've got Dostoevsky, I've got Pushkin, Turgenev. I've got, I've got everyone. And I don't have one single classical female writer. These books were translated, and these are originals, by the way. I'm boastfully telling you that they're published by Progress Publishers in Russia. Yeah, and they're like, yeah, they're that's why I'm calling them my treasure trove. But not one. Yeah.
So one quick thing about Russian literature and translation. These are wonderful keepsakes, but if you're going to reread Dostoevsky or any of the others, I would urge you to read the new translation by the husband and wife team of Richard Pevere and Larissa Volkonsky, because she's Russian, he's, I think, American, and they work together and they produce the best, most readable, most nuanced translations of Russian literature, people don't realize that when you read something in literature, translation is, read something in a foreign, you know, the who the translator is and how they translate is everything.
Absolutely, absolutely. I agree with you on that. So Naima, my next question to you is, I read this article, and according to Olga Castro, who is an associate professor in translation studies at the School of Modern Languages and Cultures at the University of Warwick, a significant gender gap in what gets published in translation, a gender gap in literary awards, and a significant gender gap in what books in translation are reviewed. That's what she said. So if you're not reviewed, you're not relevant to the conversation. How would you comment on that?
I think you bring up a very valid point, which we will address at length in the next panel, which highlights the roles of editors. I think the space that you and your team have created is once again an example of the fact that basically these conversations and actions which come off of these conversations are not happening because there isn't a safe space for these conversations. So we need more spaces which are mission-driven, which are intent-driven, which are serving women, and which are there, you know, with the target or with the agenda of actually putting literature from underrepresented regions out in the world. I think it comes down to the alertness, the sense of purpose with which we are creating and curating spaces and how we are managing them, and also coming down to a very practical concern, what is the output in terms of productivity? Because that's, you know, ultimately it's a game of numbers. Who gets reviewed, who gets remembered, and who gets forgotten? It's a very complex cycle. And you move through the cycle, you realize that it's actually a game of numbers. So at every step, there has to be a planning. There has to be, you know, some proactive planning. And I believe once we have that agenda in place and once all the important actors are, you know, on board, we can actually look at a way forward.
Absolutely, absolutely. Rabania, do you have anything to add to that?
I think I'll pass this question because I don't have a lot of experience in publishing and with editors. I've worked in translation, but not on the publishing level. So I'll just pass this question.
Okay, no problem. So my last question, which is, which is why I wanted to wrap up the other ones, is what are some of the challenges when it comes to translation works, translate projects of translation? Zarmine, you can go first.
Thank you, Sabine. I think there's a real, Naima said that there are really good translators, male and female translators in Pakistan, there are, but I think that by and large, there's a very limited understanding of what translation is. So about 2 years back, abhi to COVID year ke baad, I don't even remember, was it last year? Was it the year before last? I did a course in the summer school. I think teacher training, BNU has this summer school, and they asked me to come and do a workshop and speak about translations and as a publishing house being set up. And one of the questions that we asked all these teachers sitting over there and people who were interested in language was, do you think that you could translate? If you had all the time in the world, like we're not talking about, I'm busy. If you were given an assignment, do you think that you could translate? Every single one of them raised their hands and said, yes, of course. So then my next question was, okay, how proficient are you in the other language? I can speak it. How many books have you read in the other language? Very, almost nobody raised their hand. How much do you read in the language, in Urdu, the language that you are going to be translating into, or translating from? Nothing. They don't read, but they think that my final question was, do you think Google Translate is a valid way of translation? Nearly everybody said yes. So then we moved, that was the starting point. And then we moved on to the workshop. And by the end of it, I asked the same question and nobody raised their hand. Because the understanding of what it takes to translate is just not there.
Naima?
Actually, Zarmina, what you're saying, I couldn't agree more with that, because the conversations that I've had in communities in the UK and the way it expands your mind and the kind of reception that your work gets in a market like the UK, it really makes you want to work 10 times harder. But in Pakistan, sometimes we feel that the mentalities are very limited around the literalness of translation or whatever. But what I would like to iterate here is that those concerns around quality, around the actual craft of translation, they come much later. Our problems are really at the beginning of the funnel, at the, you know, at the level of setting an agenda and getting people on board and then ensuring that every year a certain number of projects are commissioned and they go out in the world every single year. Quality control, craft, and you know, learning around that, it's a very valid concern. And the translations which represent Pakistani literature should be world-class. And I believe that they can be if the right conversations are opened up in the right communities. But before we get to those conversations about craft, there are foundational issues which will spur the projects without which we actually have no agenda and no set target and no set measurable volume of translated work going out.
So what needs to be, so what now? What needs to be done? Naima, you go first, then Zarmina, and then Rabania.
You know, perhaps for a next iteration of this this conversation about what now. If you remember, Zarmina, we were on a panel hosted by another platform, Learn, some years ago. And we had the same conversation. And I think every time it comes to what now, there's this big question mark. So I would actually like to state an agenda for the next panel. I think on the next panel, we should actually have publishers and translators face-to-face. We should actually have them face-to-face because there are some really hard, difficult questions that need to be asked and that need to be answered. Otherwise, this conversation goes nowhere.
I don't have anything more to add than yes. We do keep talking about it. We can keep on talking about it, but until there is a direct conversation between the people who make it happen and the people who want to make it happen, it's not going to happen. So I just second what Naima said.
Rabania?
I think I agree with Zarmina on what they said about challenges, but I think with my journey with translation started when we were translating journey bhi nahi main kahungi the you know ek aisa moment okay now this is something I really enjoy pehle tha ki ha mujhe pasand hai मुझे उर्दू जबान में इंटरेस्ट था कि है बट माय होल जर्नी स्टार्टेड विद ट्रांसलेशन व्हेन वी वर ट्रांसलेटिंग अ प्ले अ वेरी फेमस प्ले इन उर्दू एंड द प्ले वाज इन इंग्लिश और हम उसको उर्दू में ट्रांसलेट कर रहे थे एंड आई रियलाइज्ड कि नोबडी हैड एनी इंटरेस्ट इन द क्लास एंड वी आई थिंक वी हैड अ क्लास ऑफ 30 पीपल 35 पीपल And I obviously knew के जब आप friends के साथ बैठते हैं आप रिश्तेदारों में बैठते हैं तो आपको समझ आती है कि people are not really interested कि उर्दू जबान में क्या हो रहा है अच्छा उर्दू जबान का कोई लिटरेचर हो रहा है कोई फेस्टिवल हो रहा है कुछ हो रहा है but when I was in that class I realized के as this assignment and as this very interesting play and play हमने करना भी है हमने कॉस्ट्यूम्स भी पहनने हैं हमने बजटिंग भी करनी है हमने हमें एक क्या कहते हैं प्रोडक्शन टीम भी बनानी है हमें सब करना है एंड दिस क्रिएटिव ग्रुप इज नॉट इंटरेस्टेड इन डूइंग दिस बिकॉज द स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट इज उर्दू या ट्रांसलेटिंग इट वॉज नॉट कि अच्छा हम सेट लगाएंगे हमें पैसे भी मिलेंगे हम यू नो पीछे पूरा पूरा पेंट करेंगे एंड यू नो कॉस्ट्यूम्स बनाएंगे मेकअप होगा it was not that. There was no, you know, like a koi incentive nahi tha. This was no motivation to let these art students to get into translation. And I think वहाँ से मुझे ये लगता है कि इंटरेस्ट नहीं है लोगों का, और जिन लोगों का नहीं है उनका आगे डेवलप नहीं होगा. तो मे बी जब हम स्कूलों में या स्कूल्स में या कॉलेजेस की जो हमारी एज होती है, मे बी वी कैन फर्स्ट डेवलप द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ लैंग्वेज लाइक जर्मीन मेंशन, एंड देन मे बी देयर वुड बी मोर एक्टिविटीज दैट develop the interest of the language itself first, and then uske baad translation kya hai, kyun hai, zuban boli kaisi jati hai, zuban ki construction kya hai, script kya hai, kya kaun se lafz kis tarike se bole jate hain. Aur translation mein to aur bhi mazey ki baat hai ki urdu mein kai cheezon ko aap jis tarah se बोलते हैं वो अंग्रेजी में जाके बिल्कुल ही, बहुत और लैंग्वेजेस में भी होता है बट मेरा उर्दू और अंग्रेजी का ही ज्यादा रहा है. तो जब आप करते हैं तो उसमें आपको समझ आती है कि कितना पॉलिटिकली और सोशली भी इनके मतलब बदल गए हैं. तो आई थिंक के ये चीजें इनमें बहुत सारी लेयर्स हैं. लेकिन जब हम ये, जब कोई बच्चा ये सुनता है कि उर्दू, तो एकदम से हो जाता है कि अच्छा ठीक है, या अंग्रेजी, हाँ अंग्रेजी तो हम बोल लेंगे, या बिल्कुल ये गूगल ट्रांसलेशन वाली बात. तो मुझे लगता है मे बी जब हम कॉलेजेस में होते हैं या यूनिवर्सिटीज में होते हैं बच्चे, तो मे बी उनके साथ ऐसी एक्टिविटीज की जाएं कि एटलीस्ट जो जिन लोगों में वो कनेक्शन है जैसे मेरे में था, मे बी वो कहीं ना कहीं आगे जाके डिवेलप हो जाए थ्रू एक्टिविटीज, ताकि we don't lose more people on translation and on writings and on narrating and you know is tarah ka. So maybe we, there can be activities that develop interest in language just generally when children are growing up, mujhe ye lagta hai.
So I think you should definitely check out Joy of Urdu.
Yes I'm familiar with it.
Yeah. So because that is something, you know, whatever you're talking about, that is. And not just that, they're doing more. So last words from all three of you, and perhaps an answer to, you know, why Rabania, I wanted Rabania to be on this panel is because she's the voice of the next generation, Gen Z or millennials. So in response to that, and also a wrap up, you know, an end note where we can say, you know, conclude our session.
I'd just like to add one little point to what Rabania said, and I love that you speak in Urdu, Rabania, and I love that you're so comfortable with it. When we were putting together the first book with the publisher, my first book with the publisher, we made it a point to include the Urdu originals at the very end, because somewhere at the back of our mind, we were very clear that through the translation, we were directing people to the actual Urdu version. And a lot of people, a lot of readers came back and told me that they enjoyed the Urdu version and they read it. And that if it had not been included in the translation, they would probably not have made the effort to go out, seek. So, yeah.
My comment just will continue to what Naima said, because this is a book that we use for a lot of the things that we read in this every Sunday at 7 p.m. Pakistan time. We have this event called with Dr. Arfa called Himaqatein. And there are so many things that we've read in this, which have made me want to get up and go out and find the Urdu original. The same thing happened with the, you know, Ibn Safi's thing, that mystery stories that Bilal Tanvir translated. I loved them. And that's when I went and I, you know, bought the entire series, because I, not that I've had the time to read it, but I will, I want to, because I'm curious. The same thing happened with his translation of, which one? I think I have it here. Chakki Vada mein Visal. Love in Chakki Vada. Mm. And brilliant. He did that translation. So translations, I think, or jo baat Rabania aap keh rahi thi, bilkul sahi hai ke jo aajkal bachche hain, wo aap agar Urdu ki baat karte hain, to wo sochte hain ke isse zyada koi bore cheez ho nahi sakti. Aur kyun hum apna waqt barbaad karein. अंग्रेजी, और वो भी बुरी अंग्रेजी, यानी कि कोई भी आप जुबान जबान सॉरी कोई भी जबान सही उसमें आप सही गुफ्तगु कर लें. तो बात यह है कि ये जो एक कॉन्सेप्ट है, आई थिंक कंसेप्चुअली जो जॉय ऑफ उर्दू काम करना चाह रही है वो ये है कि आप कंसेप्चुअली लोगों का चेंज द माइंडसेट टुवर्ड्स उर्दू. दैट इज कि आप उसको एक मुख्तलिफ तरीके से लोग उसको देखें, उसको परसीव करें, तो उस तक वो पहुंचेंगे. और हम उसको बायलिंगुअल प्लेटफॉर्म के थ्रू करते हैं क्योंकि बहुत से बच्चे जो है वो उसको इतना डर जाते हैं, तो उनको जब आप ये दिखाते हैं इतना मुश्किल नहीं है. वी वॉन्ट टू मेक इट एक्सेसिबल फॉर एग्जैक्टली द सेम रीजन दैट रबानिया मेंशन्ड. थैंक यू
रबानिया. जस्ट वन मिनट फॉर योर.
या आई थिंक हम बस अपनी कोशिश कर रहे हैं और हमारे साथ और भी लोग हैं जो जितना जॉय ऑफ पाकिस्तान है या तस्वीर घर में हम अपनी थोड़ी थोड़ी कोशिश कर रहे हैं. आप लोगों ने ये इतना बड़ा फेस्टिवल अरेंज किया है इस उसके लिए, तो आई थिंक कि कोशिश तो जारी है एंड आई यू नो फिंगर्स क्रॉस्ड आई बिलीव के क्योंकि पिछले 5-6-7-8 सालों में ये चेंज आया है एकदम से कि उर्दू एकदम से कूल बन गई है और उर्दू एकदम से उर्दू का कंपैरिजन हो गया कि नहीं नहीं अंग्रेजी में लफ्ज उतना रोमांटिक नहीं है लेकिन उर्दू में है. तो चलो उसी चक्कर में कुछ फायदा हो गया है, तो मुझे लगता है कि बेहतर होगा और बेहतर होगा. सो आई थिंक वी शुड ऑल जस्ट कीप डूइंग व्हाट वी आर डूइंग.
आई थिंक इट्स द रियलाइजेशन दैट पीपल आर having now that you know a word in Urdu is you know for an Englishman romantic would have more you know feeling to it and you know as a person whose mother tongue is Urdu that you know he would be or she would be more attracted or you know the word romance in Urdu would make more sense to it. So I think it's relative but the realization is now happening. I guess that's what my perception is, and that you know they're realizing you know the beauty and the lyricism of Urdu.
Yeah, it also has to do a lot with identity. So I think ab people are just opening up ke this is who we are. So I think it's a good thing.
True. Thank you so much, everyone, for this enlightening discussion, and I look forward to Naima, our conversation
very soon, inshallah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much,
Jamine, Rabania.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye.